All right, ladies and gentlemen, let me call this July meeting into effect for the Valdosta Lowndes County Zoning Board of Appeals. Everyone in attendance will please make sure and sign in on the attendance sheet at the back of the room. Before we begin, I will explain the process for the meeting. I will call each case on a case-by-case name and case number. City or county representative staff will come to the lectern to present the facts of the case. After the presentation, the board may or may not ask staff questions. Once the board has heard the case and asked all questions necessary of the staff, we will move to hearing from either the applicant or the applicant's representation. After hearing from the applicant, we will hear from anyone who wishes to express support for the case. Finally, we will hear from anyone who wishes to express opposition to the case. Anyone addressing the board will please come to the lectern and give their name and address for the record. For clarity and respect, we ask that only the person at the lectern address the board and that the audience give them an uninterrupted chance to be heard. If there is important information that you feel we need to consider, then please come to the lectern when it is your turn and you are called. In the interest of time, though, the board asks that you keep your comments brief and to the point. Please do not come to the lectern only to restate the same information we have already been given by somebody else. Once the board has had the chance to hear from all sides on the matter and ask any questions we feel are necessary, then we will render a decision. If we do not feel that the necessary information is available to render a decision today, then we may decide to table the case for the next meeting. Please be aware that this board is here today only to address variance applications to the zoning codes of Lowndes County and the City of Valdosta. This is the only matter on which the board has been given the power to render a decision. We cannot and do not have the power to address any other matters that are not covered by the zoning codes of Lowndes County or the City of Valdosta. Now I will call the first item, Lowndes County case VAR 2019-05, Jeshua and Patricia Neely.
From the actual property line of the secondary frame. The existing accessory structure is 16.15 feet off the actual property line. Thus, a variance of 8.85 feet is being requested by the Mees today.
Any questions for staff? Thank you.
Yes.
Does an applicant or the applicant's representation wish to come address the board?
I do not.
Okay. Anybody else here to speak in support of this case? Would anybody like to come speak in opposition to the case? Okay. Ms. Deborah, was there any contact staff about the case?
No, sir, none at all.
Okay. Board have any other questions, or would somebody like to make a motion?
I make a motion that we grant the variance as requested, citing criteria D.
Do we have a second?
Was that D or G?
D, dog.
All those in favor? Motion passes unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, we'll call the second case, VAR 2019-06, Emily Butler, 7715 Enoch Lake Circle.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is variance application VAR 2019-06. The applicant is Ms. Emily Butler. Ms. Butler resides at 7715 Enoch Lake Circle. The subject property is located within an R1 zoning district and is 1.47 acres in size. This case matter is one in which the Louds County Code Enforcement Office is involved. A complaint was received regarding the accessory structure being situated within the front yard. Per section 5.02.01E1 of the ULDC, unless otherwise provided, accessory structures shall be located only in a side or rear yard of the lot on which the principal building is located. Ms. Butler's lot is pie-shaped and approximately 70 feet in width in the front and narrows to around 60 feet in the rear. According to Ms. Butler, most of the lot in the rear is underwater. Thus, this is a part of her hardship of not being able to situate her 200 square feet accessory structure in the rear or side yard.
Any questions for staff?
I have a question.
Yes.
Is the accessory structure in violation, is it the one, so on the aerial, there's looks like two buildings up in the front yard. One's right adjacent to the house, one's up closer to the road.
The one closer up to the road, Chairman, I'm sorry, Chairman, Member Brantley, that would be the accessory structure in question.
Okay. What is that right next to the house?
Is there a building next to the house?
It's a concrete slab.
Do you know how long the... Do you know how long that accessory structure's been there?
I spoke with Ms. Emily today, sir, and she informed me at least 2.5 years. And if I may expound on her case a little bit, sir, this is a situation where Ms. Emily structure in the rear yard. She's very into the aesthetics of her property and taking care of it and just spending time out in the yard. And she said that she did talk with neighbors before she actually put the structure on the lot. And those that she spoke with at that time, nobody seemed to have had an issue.
Is this the type of structure that would require a permit to be placed in that?
Yes, sir, it would.
Was there a permit required?
No, sir, it was not. They have been informed by the code enforcement officer that the permit will be required depending on the outcome of your decision today.
Any other questions for staff?
Well, this came to staff attention in the form of a complaint by somebody?
Code enforcement. They are actually trying to solidify a case through the code enforcement division.
So code enforcement went down there and found it. It wasn't complaint generated.
It was complaint generated to code enforcement. Yes, sir.
Okay, so it was complaint generated, not code enforcement generated.
Right, yes, sir.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Yes.
Would the applicant or the applicant's representation like to come address the board?
Yes, sir. Sorry. Richard McFarland, 574 Street, Jackal Ranger, Rockland Park. Only bought their son home. The property, when we bought the purchase, at the same time, has no storage or accessory building access. No garage, others, two bedrooms, two baths, 500 square foot on a small lot in the Indian area. Upon purchase of that, purchase a portable shed is what it is. If you were not aware of the permit, certainly we'll take care of that if we can. Looking at the code enforcement piece of it, talking to the code enforcement, the complaint came from another property that's in the area. But upon driving out there, saw the structure that we have, and there's been multiple, you know, different homes in that area that need to be taken care of. But it was specifically our lot that had to be done. The portable shed is matching the color of the house, it's identical to that, and it's for, like I said, it's for accessory tools, lawn equipment, things like that.
I may have a question. It's pretty close up to the road. Could be moved far back on the property.
Arrival where we could put it at, we could place it in multiple different spots. So there's a driveway path that goes that route, and this is not open.
Right. Well, so I just was wondering if we moved back farther away from the street so that it wouldn't be so visible from the street closer to the home. It looks on the overhead like there is room.
There's room, yeah. I mean, 30 feet, 20 feet, it's still visible. There's room in that.
And I did notice when I go around that there is landscaping around it.
Questions for the applicant? No? Thank you. Is there anybody else here in support of this case who would like to speak?
What? I'm Jared Buchanan. I'm the next door neighbor. If you all were to try to make her put it on either side of the house, it would not fit. If it was to be put in the back of the house, it would block the lake view for her and for me as the next door neighbor. And I have no objections to the view where it's at now. It would be blessed.
You're welcome. Anyone else in support?
I'm Ben Fudge, 5442, Danny Underdrive, Foot Farm. Thank y'all for your service. I developed those lots. And I built a house for him. Can't say it was a nice thing for our family. That's a very narrow lot. There's no way to get the accessory building, the pre-built building on either side to get back into our property. Y'all mentioned the back of the building. The front of the lot in this case is the lake. It is the lake, it's the back of the lot, which we call the back, faces the road. So this is on the portion back towards the road, and there's no room in front of the house that I built for that, to put a structure out there. Per the building they put in there, Glenn said with the paint scheme and everything that we did on the house, I think we've done a real good job. As far as moving it back farther towards the house, we had a septic system back towards the road and drain fields down. That frozen, or kink in that, I think she's pretty well put it in a position that, though in position she could. I own property across from this, tract over here and several residential lots over there. And as an adjoining neighbor, I have no problems at all with this. One other thing that I'd like to, that I question, I'm at, as far as code enforcement. This is an accessory structure on a lot that is probably 6 to 8 lots to the north of Ms. Butler's. And that's towards the front, towards the road, and the house is way behind it. I don't know if that was permitted or whatever. There are precedents now there. And when you ride around the lake, they're more. Appreciate any consideration y'all give. Thank you.
Anyone else in support?
Cheryl Sheffield, I live at 7721 in the lake right next door. And Ms. Emily did ask myself and my husband if we had any problem with her putting the building there. And we told her no.
Anyone else in support?
So I'm at 7749 in the White Bay. I'm next. So of course I'm in support of her. It is very nice structure. It does match her home to a T. It's like most of the structures in the front yards of all of the ones that have them. We all try to make it blend in or match her home. We don't want it to stick out like a sore thumb. But yes, I'm in agreement.
Anyone else in support? Anyone in opposition to the case? Oh, I'm sorry.
No, in opposition.
Or do you want to speak in support?
Yes, please.
Okay.
My name is Amy Sumner. I'm president of the Independent Homeowners Association. And I can tell you that over the years, a lot of things have slipped through the cracks, so to speak, because the board changes every year. But we do have ordinances and bylaws governing the Homeowners Association. And this was not known to any of us, as far as I know, until after the fact. Now, as far as color, it's probably fine, and I have no animosity against anybody, but the structure is a metal type, and it doesn't really fit in. Now, the house actually got built there, I don't know, college, because I had to have a variance, but it is so narrow. I'm sorry, it came to this, so much better if you know before than that after, and sorry you don't hear another case, but it's the same situation. So, that's about it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else in support? Anybody else in opposition to the case? Ms. Beverly, was there a contact?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Does anybody else on the board have any questions? No? Someone would like to make a motion?
I make a motion to approve as requested, citing criteria D.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous? Thank you.
Yes.
All right, case number 3, VAR 2019-07, Don Dimmitt.
This too, Chairman, is a case that will be very similar to exactly what it is that you guys just heard. This property is also a parcel within the is a lot that is situated or parallel to a county needs on the road. Now, Enid Lake Circle, that is a private road. Therefore, it could have been looked at as, all property lines could have been looked at as a sign when they write to review in that flat years ago. But it was not. It was looked upon as acknowledging Enid Lake as an appropriate road to be a private road. And the setbacks are, they do reflect the front yard as being from the park that is parallel to the road, the right.
When I rode around that road today, I was marveling at the quality of the dirt road and thought this certainly is not a county maintained road. This is very nice. If this community is a private community, as it well says right when you drive down paved roads, this is a private community, no one coming in here. Why are we hearing these cases at all? Why is code enforcement? They have a homeowners association, they make the rules in there. It's not a public road, it's not. Why are we hearing these? And when I rode around, yeah, I saw at least six others that, well, why are we hearing all of these on one day, and why are we hearing these at all? So, if that's a private road, why are we hearing it?
Can I give you an intelligent answer right now on that conversation that I'm more than ready to research?
Okay, thank you.
May I address that?
Table all these. There's more of these coming up. Can you table all these until that's asked, until that's answered?
Yeah, I think so. I want to use six or eight or ten of these. It's ridiculous.
I did try to get Officer Bailey to just handle it at once. I didn't understand.
Okay. Any other questions for staff? Okay. We need to address the applicant first, and unless somebody wants to make a motion to table. Okay, we'll move on. Is the applicant here or the applicant's representation that would like to speak?
Any other
questions? Any other questions for the applicant? All right, sir. Anyone here in support?
I'm trying to be repetitive of clarification. The lots, the state sizes of the lots, and those are acre sizes, square footage of lots, but on those lots, there's at least 50%, half of them, two-thirds of those lots are underwater because of landlines, right, run out to the middle of that lake. That's the way we develop it all the way to the end. I also built Keith and Bob's house, Bob's house there. Same scenario with the front faces the lake. That's the front face is great. That's the, you know, that's the front. The back face is the road. It's always been a private road. We had a restricted covenants on it. We developed it in 1980. We had covenants on it, covenants running 20 years of the land, unless they're, and I don't have any knowledge of any right to agree up in the covenants. I don't know if the covenants are active or not, but the original covenants we had on the property allowed accessory buildings. I remember that specifically. They allowed it to be accessory buildings. I own the property across the street from this and whatever. I have no problems with it for Keith and Donna doing it. No disrespect shown, but the lady said that Emily's was a metal structure. Emily's is not a metal structure, it's a wood structure. But anyway, these are good people. It's a nice neighborhood. Thanks for the compliment on the road. I'm building a couple of houses down there. If you'd like to pass that on, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Anyone else in support?
My name is Bobby. I live right next to Keith, or I will in a few weeks. My house is almost finished, and I have no problem with the structures. I decide, because I feel like that they're making a practical note that they will not be a problem.
Can you give your address for the
7739 East Lake.
Which side do you live on?
That's it. I don't live out there. I'm on there.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Anyone else in support? Is there anybody here in opposition to the case?
My name is Dennis Brady. I live at 213 Ravine Drive in Madison, New Jersey. I own the property adjacent to the Demics. I've owned this since 1987. I purchased this property at Little Mr. Fletch as well. So I apparently am the one that opened the can of worms. If you don't mind, I'd like to read a prepared statement and then we'll go from there. The Demics purchased their property in November of 2016, and I believe they thought they hit the jackpot. They found a nice home on a nice lake with a weak homeowners association and an absentee owner owning the property next door. They felt so sure of themselves that they placed their dog run out of their garage door onto my property. They felt so sure of themselves that when they built their swimming pool with fell trees they put onto my property. When I saw this, I approached Mr. Demick and told him to remove them immediately. He subsequently did remove them, but I went to zoning and lodged a complaint with zoning in regard to his shelters that he put at the end of the road. Zoning never got back to me. I took it that it was taken care of. I came down in April. The structures were still there. At that time, there was, initially there was one RV and one boat. The structures were still there in April. So I lodged a subsequent complaint with zoning, Mrs. Bates. Mrs. Bates sent out the zoning officer, and now we have this nightmare. As a property owner and a homeowners association member, I look to these two systems to protect my investment. Well, my homeowners association failed, and I'm hoping that the zoning board does. Mr. Demick received a copy of the bylaws and the architectural control committee list, which I provided all a copy of, when he purchased this property, or he should have. Mr. Demick works in the construction industry, and I'm confident that he knows the requirements of building codes, inspection requirements, but apparently felt that nobody cared in Lower Lowndes County because other people violated the zoning. So, well, he could too. Well, I do care. His structures are a current flagrant violation of zoning laws, setback laws, and the inspection process, and in my opinion, devaluing my property values. So I respectfully request that the board order the removal of the structure from his front yard. And I feel it's his front yard because everybody that has a swimming pool is on the backside on the lake. So if that's the front yard, then everybody's going to be coming to you for a variance for their swimming pools that are on the lake. The backyard, front yard, no matter what, these kind of structures are nice. And I just added, you rode by there today. What did you see today? I rode by today.
Well, what did I see? The sign was down.
No, in regard to his structure.
And then he has an RV under a metal with side poles and a boat, half finished something.
Okay, there's two RVs and a boat. Where does his request for structures end? You know, as I said, when I initially went back to the beginning of the year, there was one RV and one boat. Now there's two RVs and a boat. He stopped construction because I lodged a complaint. How big was his structure going to be?
Well, right, and like I said, I saw at least six others that are clearly in violation.
I'm not questioning. I had no problem with that lady. But he, was, if you look at the picture, he put his structures right adjacent to my driveway entrance to my property. His structures are on the property line. I don't think you can get a spring between them. What went on down there is a bad association, for sure, for sure. But I'm looking to the board to help protect my property. Thank you.
I got a quick question. On these pictures you've got, are these posts?
That post is the property line, and it goes a pie shape back to the lake. The other picture shows you from the other angle. So if we go pie shape back, you see that pole back there?
Mm-hmm.
That's the lawn. So if you look, he's got these things sitting right on the lawn. And there's a setback. It would violate the setback.
Any other questions? I got a question for Deborah. What are the setbacks?
Yes, sir. For an accessory structure within an R1 zoning district, it would be 20 feet off your side yard and 10 feet off your rear. In this case, being that their rear is in that water body, so it does not exist.
But it would be 20, is that right?
Yes, on the side.
And how far are these structures off of the property line?
That I do not know.
Any other questions?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Anybody else here in opposition to the complaint?
First of all, my question is, who decided what's the front, what's the back? To me, the front of the house is where the road is when you go in. Also, all this frontage supposed to be has occurred in the last 5 or 6 years. Again, I've just been in charge for 1 year, and it's about to be over, which is a blessing. But it's in violation of the Stephen Clay Homeless Association ordinances, the bylaws and the covenants. But there again, after the fact, we see these structures. So again, Keith is correct as far as weakness has been a lot. On the crack, I guess because in part that the homeowners association is very small, there's 55 lake lots, and perhaps more is Mr. Fletch sales and bills. But as far as our covenants and bylaws, frankly, this is in violation. And I hate it that it happened again. This is after that.
I got a quick question for you. Were the covenants renewed after the 20-year?
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that.
Expiration?
Technically, they did expire, but the powers that be called it into question, and the state of Georgia legislature changed that. And now the way it reads is that the homeowners association has to agree to disband. Comes to you ask from the municipality or whatever reason. Yes, and certainly we never agreed to disband, so we still need.
Has the HOA taken any civil action in regards to these violations, or has it done anything?
No, because again, this is after the fact. We had a president, I'm not spreading rumors, I'm telling you the truth. It may not have even read the rules. And in fact, he just had to think there was no need to pay their dues because the ordinance had expired, which again they had. But so we kind of picked up the pieces at this point. Thank you for your question.
Anyone else in opposition?
My name is Martha Parton, 8069, Enoch Lake Circle, Lake Park. I was a president of the association for two different terms. So, I would like to say, number one, that the two cases are very much in opposition to one another. One is the case of a woman who has an extremely narrow yard. It would be very difficult, which is on the water, is that. It would be very difficult for her to move that structure to the rear of her home. I don't even know if she could do it on her property line. The second case is different in that. She has a self-contained building that I believe is unlocked and very neatly maintained. The second case is slightly different. It is a metal building, or not building, a quantified, that covers an RV, a boat, and then there is another RV. If one were to examine the covenants of the Enoch Lake Homeowners Association, you would find that that is in violation. One is a self-contained storage unit. The other one is to hold an RV and a boat. There has been no attempt to maintain the area around those structures. And so when he's driving in that area, of the road. One drives by two buildings that are very close to the road. And then we drive by another building where it's we have all of this jury stories. It's a matter of what is aesthetically pleasing to the environment, to the association. It does have covenants. Have they always been enforced? No, they have not. I will be very honest with you. It depends on who's present and who's on board. But if we allow this to continue, then everything at the lake, and for those of you who have visited the Knock Lake, it's really a very lovely community, and we wish to maintain it at that point. I therefore am in opposition to this proposal, unless there can be some caveats that will discuss the aesthetics of it. Thank you.
I just want to make clear, we can't address your covenants. So obviously we're here only to address the issue of the zoning ordinance and the variance to it. So you got a question?
Yes. That was a question for Deb.
Yes.
If there was no accessory building, can you store an RV in your front yard?
Yes, ma'am. We would consider it as a personal vehicle. We would simply advise the owner to not park it in a manner that would cause any issue with drive-by time.
If this accessory structure was not an accessory structure, but it was a garage connected to their home,
yes, ma'am.
Would it be permitted?
Yes, ma'am. That would be just if it is attached by the roof,
yes,
then it would be considered as an addition to the home.
An addition to the home.
And it may be as large as they want.
Build a big old garage, put down RV in it, attached to the home.
Yes.
That would be permitted.
Yes.
Is there,
is there a limit on having RV together?
No, ma'am, it is not. Again, they are looked at as your personal vehicles. Just be mindful of where you park them on the property so that they are not a nuisance to your...
Even if they're a fifth wheel?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. We will allow for RVs on private property as long as they are not connected to power or sewer.
Okay, as of right now, his building, for his RV,
yes,
is in violation because it's not honoring the setbacks.
Well, here's the thing, Ms. Nancy. I was not given this case. Setbacks were not moving to me. I think I was asked a question about the line when I went out there. I did not know where the line was. The only thing that was brought to me within this application and by my code enforcement office was the fact that the structure was situated within the front yard.
If I can, just for a second.
Yes,
there's a lot of problems that we're facing face with. The reason there was no mention of setbacks in the front yard is there's no code for setbacks for accessory buildings in the street side. I'm going to rephrase that.
Okay.
The street side. Because in the code, you can't put an accessory building in the front yard. So there's nothing.
Side yard, though, there is a setback.
If there's a side yard, but if it's in the street side, if it's in the front side of the building, there's no setback.
Oh, but you would still have to be inside your setback, and there are
variables. No. You read the code. It says that the accessory buildings have to be from the front of the building back. And if it's technically in the street side, there is no setback for accessory buildings because nobody, when they did the ULDC, nobody visualized the fact that we were going to be sitting in a situation like this, that you've got accessory buildings that are in the backyard, the front yard, depending on how you want to construe it. And maybe before we get too much deeper into this, we need, and I'm willing to make a motion to table it when the time comes, to get Lowndes County to look harder at this and give us a little more guidance, because we're going to have more of these requests coming up, because we've all been down there and seen others that were in the street side, and they need, we need some guidance. What are we going to do about a property line setback in the, quote, front yard?
I think if we're anticipating more cases, then we need to get back to Gretchen's original question. Do we even have a right to be discussing these cases? With it being a private subdivision, private.
That's part of what I'm saying. Lowndes County needs to give us, as zoning board members, zoning board appeal members, a little bit more guidance, because we're trying to put a square peg in a round hole. Because there are multiple things that, if we start talking about, like the side yard setbacks, but they don't exist in the code if they're in the, quote, front street side, because you can't put the building in the front street side to begin with. The variance that they're asking for is, can I put the building here? But there's no, if you read it, there's no mention of, I need a setback to put it in here, because there is no requirement that it be set back from the property. Is anyone else for speaking?
I thought there was some sort of
discussion.
Yeah, I've got a comment. I thought there was some sort of requirement that when you apply for a variance, or submit an application for a variance request, you have to provide like a site plan, like some sort of a layout showing.
Where
everything sits, how close it is to the property line.
They have really been trying, since we do not have this Carmella anymore, this Carmella, Bresville, our previous zoning administrator, and we do not have an acting zoning administrator. I think that they have been trying to show some leniency until we can get all of those thorough directions on how we will be flowing. Chairman, I did understand, it sounds as if you were saying, we're asking for something that the code says that we cannot do. Is that where you were going with that?
It is my understanding, and I'm calling from
past experience. Yes.
Number one, accessory buildings in the city of Alhassa and Lowndes County, the code always said they had to be in the rear yard. Mm-hmm. They cannot be forward from the front of the main structure. They can be parallel with it, they can be even with it, they can go back in the back.
That's right.
But because there's no provision in the ULDC for a accessory building in the front yard, that's why the applicant, it just says, you know, I want a variance so I can put my building in my front yard. So there, we're rushing into some areas that we really don't quite understand.
I see where you're going with that, so.
And as far as the request for setbacks, because there's no requirement for setbacks for buildings in the front yard.
Yes, I see exactly where you're going with that.
And I think we need to get a little bit more feedback. And I also, if this is in fact a private area, then I think Lowndes County needs to step up and say, if it, we do or don't have actual enforcement in this area, because it is private.
And we, if I can give clarity to that question, Lowndes County do have the governing authority over Lowndes County in its entirety. The fact that that is a private road simply means that Lowndes County will not maintain it. The homeowners association, they're responsible for the road. So that's the privacy thing. The part of these lots are the portion of the lots that are parallel to the roadway. Even though they have a HOA with president and staff and restricted covenants, which is great. Normally, most restricted covenants are more stringent than our local codes. They cannot or should not be less than, but we do not enforce restricted covenants. So we wouldn't even know what your covenants are saying, so it would be cool for their team to know what your local government or brings.
It sounds like she just answered the question that we were wanting her to find out the answer to the road. That regardless of who the road belongs to,
yes, ma'am,
the county still has jurisdiction in there.
Yes.
Which to me,
yes, ma'am.
I have one more question. If this structure was pushed back on the lot to be next to the house, just for discussion's sake, then it would have to be how many feet off the property line? What is the side yard setback? Is it 20 feet?
Yes.
20 feet off the side
line.
So he might not be able to be 20 feet off the side yard because he doesn't wide, he's only 112 feet wide.
Mm-hmm.
His house has to be at least 20 feet off the side yard. If I get this right, but if he was, if he had, say, 40 feet over there of his 112, he could put a 20-foot structure right next to his house, be 20 feet off the lot line.
If
but
this,
he can't be off the lot line in front of the, on the street side of the house.
There's no specifications to my knowledge as far as setbacks in a, quote, front yard or street facing area. There's no setback requirements because there's no provision or no expectation people are going to put an accessory building in there.
The chairman is right. The code is basically. You cannot, the code says that you cannot situate an accessory structure within the front yard. However, we have enforced the ULDC to where we have allowed citizens to flush a structure with the home. That is, of course, as long as the home meets at least the minimum building front setbacks for the building. Now, you could flush your accessory structure that way, but of course, and like the vice chairman said, it could not protrude beyond the home.
And if he made an addition to his home with a roof line, he could do
whatever he wanted, as long as he could meet the setbacks.
If that building were properly situated, would it, the type of construction that it is be allowed? Would an open metal building be allowed?
Sure. That is considered as an accessory structure. Yes.
But of course, in the backyard.
Side or rear?
Is there any screening required against?
Given, forgive me, but it was that house sheltered.
Excuse me.
Forgive me, but is that house sheltered?
We're not recognizing.
Sorry.
Any other questions? Is there any contact?